Good evening. I would like to welcome y'all all here tonight. My name is Dan Dahlberg. I'm also from the University of Minnesota, as is Jim Kakalios, the night speaker. I would like to say a few things about Jim in way of an introduction. He is a Taylor Distinguished Professor at the University of Minnesota in the School of Physics and Astronomy. He's also a fellow in the AAAS, in the American Association for the Advancement of Science, and in the American Physical Society. In 2014, he won the AAAS Public Engagement Award from the AAAS. In 2016, he won the Gamant Award from the American Physical Society for Public Engagement and Outreach. In addition to his research, as you can see from the awards he's gathered, he also is very active in science communication and outreach. His popular science book, The Physics of Superheroes, was published in 2005. It's now with the second edition, it's been translated into 7 different languages. Since 2010, we have been doing these public lectures in association with the American Physical Society March Meeting, which is here this week, which is a collection of about 10,000 physicists that visit different cities every year for their annual conference. And we have a public lecture given by Jim to illustrate to the public a connection between the basic research that we're reporting here and comic books and the things that you find humorous and could never happen, okay? And these programs are supported by the Division of Condensed Matter Physics in the American Physical Society and the Division of Materials Physics. Now, before we start, I would like to see a show of hands of those of you that are not associated with the conference. How many of you are from the New Orleans area? Everybody, let's see a show of hands, please. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, and without further ado, I will give you Jim Kakalios.
Thank you very much, Dan. Thank you all for coming. So the people who are not members of the APS, don't worry, the talk should be just at the right level. I tried to make it so simple that even the physicists could understand it. Let me begin by thanking the Division of Materials Physics and the Division of Condensed Matter Physics for sponsoring these series of talks and for hosting me, and also Professors Dahlberg, Brian Schwartz, and Ivan Schuler for doing all the organizational work over the years. I greatly appreciate it. There's a great deal of effort on outreach, and here at the APS, just this week, there are sessions from Physics Girl to the Physics Bus, Physics for Everyone, Physics that Changed the World. That was an interesting session talking about light-emitting diodes, lithium batteries, GPS, MRI, LASIK surgery, all sorts of things that have really transformed our lives. And a lot of that work started as research that was reported here at this meeting. Right after this talk, there will be a staged reading of a play about the life of and science of Richard Feynman. So I want to promote that. Now, superheroes, I found, have been able to help with science communication. Usually, when a physicist is asked by a reporter, tell us in layman's terms what your breakthrough means, the scientist manages to just repeat the technical material that was in the original report. And one doesn't want to dumb things down, but if you can't explain something simply, my own opinion, I think at a fundamental level, you don't really understand it. And so I hope, and by using superheroes, somehow it's if you use Spider-Man or Superman, you can actually get across what these breakthroughs mean. So, a little background, how did a mild-mannered physics professor become associated with Spider-Man and Superman? In my day job, I'm a condensed matter experimentalist. So experimentalist means I work in a laboratory. Condensed matter is a fancy way of saying solid-state physics. My research actually goes from the nano to the neuro. I do work where we grow nanocrystals of one type of semiconductor and embed them in an amorphous matrix of a different kind of semiconductor in order to make better materials for solar cells or thin film transistors. And I have collaborations with professors in neuroscience where we use techniques we developed to study electronic noise in disordered semiconductors and apply them to voltage fluctuations in the brain. But that's not why I'm here tonight. I'm here tonight because back in 2001, I created a freshman seminar class at the University of Minnesota that was originally called Everything I Know About Science I Learned from Reading Comic Books, which my colleagues say explains a great deal. Now, this is a real physics class, but there's not an inclined plane or pulley in sight. Rather, all the examples come from superhero comic books, and as much as possible, those cases where the superheroes get their science right. I have a cover here from an old Superman comic. This is back in the 1960s. I actually bought this comic when it first came out for the grand total of 12 cents. I'm very old. because Superman was visiting a college campus, and I was very interested in a kid and what life in college was going to be like. And I knew the Superman part wasn't too accurate, but there were things in the comic book that did turn out to be correct. Namely, all professors at all times always wear caps and gowns. And all professors are 800-year-old white men. Now, the class was a success, and then in the spring of 2002, the very first Spider-Man movie was going to open. This is the one with Tobey Maguire, directed by Sam Raimi. And I thought this might be a good opportunity to get some science into the newspaper. So I wrote up an essay about how the death of Spider-Man's girlfriend, Gwen Stacy, in, as you all know, Amazing Spider-Man number 121, turns out to be a textbook illustration of Newton's laws of motion. They published this in the Minneapolis Star Tribune, my local newspaper, and the University of Minnesota sent out a little press release saying, well, Spider-Man's on the big screen, but if you want to know about the science of superheroes, the person to ask is Professor Jim Kakalios, teaches this freshman seminar, blah, blah, blah. The university has put out press releases about me before, about my work on disordered semiconductors and electronic noise. Result? Zero. You write one story about Spider-Man, however. So the article came out on Friday, the press release went out on Friday, the Spider-Man movie opened on Friday. By Monday, there were calls from CNN, BBC, the London Times, the Associated Press came to my office, where I just happened to have these lecture demonstration tools on hand. That was a lucky break. You know, at this stage of my career, I've reconciled myself to the fact that I could win 3 Nobel Prizes, and I know what photo they're using in my obituary. I tell this to my friends and my colleagues, and they say, win 3 Nobel Prizes how? In a crap game? But this article actually went around the country. This is a clipping from the Chicago Sun-Times that my sister-in-law sent me. It actually went around the world. A graduate student brought back a clipping from Turkey, where I think I know what they're saying about me. And then I started showing up in places that physics professors don't normally appear. So, this weekend, you're having family game night, and you're relaxing. If you play Trivial Pursuit, and you happen to have Volume 6, I can tell you right now that if you get card 291, the science question, the answer is kryptons. The question is, what planet's gravity did science professor Jim Kakalios estimate by calculating the force needed to leap over an Earth building in a single bound? Now, I didn't even know about this. One of the graduate students brought the card to my attention, so I borrowed the card. I went down to my department headquarters, you know, the main office. I went to my department chairman, showed him the card, and I said, Alan, who's the most famous scientist you know? And he looked at the card, and he looked at me, and he said, Stephen Hawking. Who's not a genius? Oh, well, then it's you. But the superheroes actually get their science more right than you might think. I'm not talking about the superpowers. That's clearly impossible. And I don't see my job as just being like Dr. No or Professor Grump and saying, well, this could never happen, and this is impossible, and what's the deal with the Hulk's pants anyway? And so what I'd rather do is I grant each character a one-time miracle exemption from the laws of nature. And I say, well, if you were super strong, or could stretch like a rubber band, or could run at super speed like the Flash here, could you run across the ocean? Drag people behind you in your wake, run up the side of a building, all things that these characters are shown doing in the comic books, all things that are correct from a physics point of view once you make that suspension of disbelief. So here's the Flash, a DC Comics superhero who has super speed. And a crook is shooting at him, but the Flash is faster than a speeding bullet. But there are innocent bystanders. And the Flash is not super strong, he's not bulletproof, he's just very fast. But we see here, with a sweeping motion, the Flash plucked them, the bullets, right out of the air before they could harm him. Editor's note, Flash's action in stopping the bullets is similar to that of a baseball fielder who stops a hot grounder by letting his glove travel momentarily in the same direction as the ball. This is a correct use of the Flash's super speed. Just a few days ago, I grabbed an object that was going 600 miles an hour. When I poured myself some ginger ale on the airplane. It's going 600 miles an hour, I'm going 600 miles an hour, not a problem. If I'm standing still and it's going 600 miles an hour, then I have a problem. So here is some correct science in a superhero comic book. Here's another adventure. The Flash is trying to run at the speed of light, and he's having some difficulty. And we see up here, the mighty monarch of motion pours it on. They always gave these characters, you know, alliterative nicknames. The Flash was the Scarlet Speedster, the Crimson Comet, the Viceroy of Velocity. And the Flash is thinking, but he's trying to run at the speed of light, but he's finding it hard. It's taking me a little longer than usual to reach light velocity. I wonder if I'm tired or something that could affect my super speed. Good gosh, there's no doubt of it. I'm slowing down. I'm going slower and slower despite all my efforts. I can't go any faster because I'm getting heavier. Something's happening to me. Now, those who know Einstein's special theory of relativity know exactly why the Flash is getting heavier as he tries to run at the speed of light. An alien is shooting him with a gravity increasing ray. But if you take it out of context, it's a beautiful illustration of Einstein's principle. One last example from The Flash, because I just love this, because it's just so silly. In this story, for reasons that are too Byzantine to go into, The Flash can't touch anyone without killing them. And he wants to capture a crook, but he doesn't want to kill him. So what does he do? He runs about half a mile away, and he starts running around, racing around a pear tree. And he's thinking, by setting up a current of air, I've shaken those pears off their branches. And the next panel, now by racing swiftly back to the car, I'll start a suction to draw the pears after me. And then I'll duck down, and the pears traveling at high speed will do my job for me. Thereby illustrating Newton's third law of motion, which is usually expressed for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction, or as I like to phrase it, forces come in pairs. I heard those groans. So let me just remind you that I am a teacher. Therefore, your hatred only makes me stronger. Now, this may sound like a silly premise, but there's actually something serious that I'm trying to accomplish here. It will no doubt come as a shock to you, but some of my students actually find physics dull. I know, I feel the same way. This was driven home to me one day when I was going back to the physics building. I saw two students leaving. They had just had an exam returned to them. I want to quote exactly what I overheard, but in deference to the APS, I'll clean it up. The taller student said to his friend, I'm going to bleeping buy low and bleeping sell high. I don't need to know about no bleeping balls thrown off no bleeping cliffs. Now, I maintain that there's at least three nuggets of wisdom contained in these two lines. The first, of course, the secret to financial success. So if you get nothing else out of tonight's talk, now you know you should be buying low and selling high. I've been doing it wrong all these years. The second, for those of you who are scholars of English grammar and usage, will have noticed that bleeping can be both an adjective and an adverb, though I suspect some of you knew that already. And the third is that many students don't find their introductory physics classes relevant. This is driven home by the standard student's complaint, when am I ever going to use this in my real life? Interestingly enough, whenever I use superheroes to illustrate physics principles, students never wonder when they're going to use this in their real life. Apparently, they all have plans after graduation that involve spandex and patrolling the city. And knowing as I do how many mad scientists there are out there, that's probably a good thing. But the superheroes are there just to illustrate the physics principles. Once we get the physics principles, we can show how they do apply to real life. From everything from how airbags save lives to how cell phones work. So this evening, I'll give you some examples from my course and the book, and I hope you're so busy enjoying the superhero ice cream sundae that you don't notice that I'm sneakily getting you to eat your spinach at the same time. Now, one thing in preparing this talk, it occurred to me that superheroes and physics back in the 1960s had one thing in common, a lack of diversity. There was typically, all the superheroes tended to look the same. And in physics and chemistry, engineering, in the science, technology, engineering, mathematics fields, there's a growing effort to try to expand the talent pool. And this is not due to any issues of political correctness, but simply that given the problems that we need to address, we need all the talent we can get. In this case, we can follow the lead from the superheroes. Because if you go from, that was in the 1960s, but if you go to the comic book shop today, you'll find that Captain America is now Sam Wilson, that Jane Foster is Thor, that Amadeus Cho is the Hulk, that Riri Williams is Iron Man, Miles Morales is Spider-Man, that there's actually much more diversity in the superhero world. They even some new characters, Ms. Marvel, Kamala Khan, is a Pakistani-American Muslim, lives in New Jersey. It Ben Grimm, the Thing from the Fantastic Four, was recently identified about 10 years ago as being Jewish, and this came out when he was fighting a villain, and the villain said, "Wait, you're Jewish?" And Ben Grimm said, "Yeah, why?" He goes, "You don't look it." But it's perhaps not so surprising that we're getting this diversity because, after all, the first superhero was an immigrant, I think an illegal alien. As they say in Hamilton, immigrants get stuff done. And I don't know about truth or justice, but that's the American way. This is Women's History Month, and I want to bring up a new character who's actually one of my favorite new characters, the unbeatable squirrel girl. She has all the powers of a squirrel and all the powers of a girl. And she really is unbeatable. She is a computer science major in college, and frequently her computer science classwork shows up when she's fighting some villain. She once had to, and she wound up teaching me and teaching everyone who read the comic, how to count to 31 using just the fingers of one hand. And you do it in binary. So you have 2 to the 0, 2 to the 1, 2 to the 2, 2 to the 3, 2 to the 4, and this is 9, this is 31. Anyway, I like Squirrel Girl. Back in March of 2016, a website contacted me and asked me some questions about superheroes and punching. And then a few months later, in Squirrel Girl's physics class, she's studying about the physics of punching. And I don't know if that's supposed to be me or And she says, I forgot how physics is totally amazing. So hopefully I'll convince you that physics is totally amazing as well. At this meeting, the APS members know this, of course, there's over 10,000 scientists that specialize in solid-state physics, material science, and I would like to, in my talk this evening, give you a sense of the types of things that they're working on. So the first thing we consult is Spider-Man. They're not looking at Spider-Man comic books, though perhaps they should, but there is aspects of Spider-Man that the real physics that is being worked on would help make Spider-Man a reality. So when you think about Spider-Man, you think about wall crawling and web slinging. For wall crawling, you see Spider-Man can adhere to surfaces, but so does a gecko lizard. And a gecko lizard was able to climb walls, cross the ceiling, using static cling. If you look at the foot of a gecko, and who hasn't at some point, and you zoom in with a microscope, and you zoom in, and you zoom in, and you zoom in, that there are millions of microscopic filaments on each of the little pads on each toe of the gecko. And these filaments help the gecko stick to walls through an electrostatic force described as the van der Waals attraction. This is a very weak force. If you increase the distance between the filament and the wall by a factor of 10, by 10 times, the force becomes a million times weaker. That's why the filaments have to be so small, because you need to have a large surface area to volume ratio so they could get very close to the wall. And what will happen is fluctuations in charge in the filament will induce an opposite fluctuation of charge in the wall, and opposite charges attract, and the gecko can stick to the wall this way. Researchers are developing gecko tape. This is tape that has millions of microscopic filaments and thus can adhere to surfaces using the same physical phenomena that the gecko lizard does. And here is a paper. This is a figure from a paper in, I believe it was Nature Materials, published by André Geim, who would go on to win the Nobel Prize, not for his action figure collection, but where the figure is being held up by gecko tape, not glue or scotch tape, but this gecko tape. And there are difficulties, and scientists and engineers are working to overcome them to scale up this tape so that it could actually hold a person. Right now, you can't hold anything that heavy, but they're working on it, and they're learning more about the materials as they do this, and I can promise you now that if they ever get gecko tape, and it's like as common, say, as Velcro, I'm never waiting for the elevator again. When you think about web swinging, of course you think about Spider-Man.
Here Who we am have... I? I'm Spider-Man.
Here we have examples. Shooting his web line out, a very narrow line. We could estimate how fast he's going by seeing how long it takes him to pass the traffic. Oh, coming up here is a nice example of circular motion. Now, in the comic books, Spider-Man's webbing is an artificial webbing that he's manufactured. And it's held under high pressure in these little canisters, and when he presses a button on the web shooter, the webbing comes out, and depending on how he presses the button, it can come out as a single line or a spreading net or even a thick adhesive. And there's actually some very interesting, fascinating material science about spider webs and real spider silk. They have millions of nanocrystals that provide the strength and rigidity, and between the nanocrystals are connected by polymers, which are elastic and can stretch. And the whole thing is encased in a fluid-filled tube to uniformly distribute the force. Material scientists would dearly love to be able to make artificial spider web, because then you'd be able to make lightweight clothing that would be stronger than Kevlar. We know how strong spider silk is, but how do we know how strong Spider-Man's webbing is? Well, the way you do this, you test the strength of materials, is typically you continue to add force to it and see at what point does the material fail, otherwise known as break. Fortunately, in the second Spider-Man movie, they did this experiment for us. Here we see Spider-Man trying to stop a runaway train. I see that look in class a lot. Now, from that, we can figure out the tensile strength of Spider-Man's webbing. We can estimate the diameter of the webbing. We can count the number of web lines that he shot out. We can guess, we can look up the mass of the subway trains, the elevated trains. We can determine its initial velocity by seeing how long it took to pass city blocks before he shot the webbing out. We can see the measure, we can count how many blocks, the distance over which the webbing stretches. And we conclude that the webbing has to have a tensile strength of 1,000 megapascals, which is equivalent to 145,000 pounds per square inch. Now, real steel has a tensile strength of only about 250 to 500 megapascals. But spider silk has a tensile webbing about 1,200 megapascals. So if Spider-Man's webbing is as strong as real spider silk, then that's okay, which just illustrates one of my points that I always stress in class: they couldn't put it in a movie if it wasn't true. Now, as strong as spider silk is, it's nowhere near one of the strongest materials that we know of. That would be carbon nanotubes, which have a tensile strength of about 60,000 megapascals. So a carbon nanotube, to make a carbon nanotube, you start with pencil lead. Pencil lead is carbon, where the atoms are arranged in hexagons, in sheets. And the bonds in these sheets are extremely strong. The bonds between the carbon atoms in the sheet are stronger than the bonds between carbon atoms in diamond. The bonds between the sheets are extremely weak, which is why it's good for pencils. When you write with a pencil, what you're doing is you're peeling the graphite off layer by layer. And so it's very good for that. And then if you peel this off, and here's an electron microscope picture, using some quantum mechanics, we can actually image the atoms. Each one of these white dots is a carbon atom on the surface of graphite, and we can see the nice hexagon arrangement of the carbon atoms there. If we take a single sheet, that's rather special. We give it a special name, graphene. If you roll it up into a tube, then you've got a carbon nanotube. It has about a diameter of about 1.2 nanometers, which is about the distance of four atoms end to end. And this is the material that's extremely strong. If you were to take a series of carbon nanotubes and braid them into a cable, that's no bigger than the period in a sentence in a book that you're reading, it would be able to hold up two SUVs. Again, we know how to make them single nanotubes. We don't know how to make them in mass quantities enough that we can braid them into these cables. But people are working on them here at this meeting, and perhaps someday that will come, and then we'll definitely have all sorts of new technologies enabled by that. I should also talk about the single layer before you roll it up into a tube, graphene. This also is extremely strong. I know this because I read comic books. A few years ago, Iron Man had changed his suit of armor from the traditional red and yellow into something that looks like he's just stepped right out of the Genius Bar at the Apple Store. And as part of this new look, he's dropped the faceplate so his adoring public can see his face. But of course, this has disadvantages, namely if someone wants to shoot him point blank in the face. But it turns out that Tony Stark, Iron Man, is unharmed, and the gunman is amazed, and he explains it's called graphene, stronger than most steels, transparent. So now I've mentioned several times graphene here at this talk. So this is now officially a March APS APS March meeting talk. So the question is graphene really bulletproof? And through an amazing coincidence, the very same week that that issue of Iron Man came out, another magazine came out, Science Magazine, and here we see a preview of an article shooting bullets through graphene sheets. And scientists at Rice University sent little quartz pellets at high velocity at sheets of graphene and determined how much energy it would take to penetrate the graphene. And when you do this, you can plot the energy needed to penetrate a material versus the impact velocity. And these are most metals. These are steel, aluminum, other types of metals. This is Kevlar. This is graphene up here. It takes much more energy to penetrate graphene than it would Kevlar. And graphene is indeed invisible. It's only one atom thick, so 97% of the light goes through it. So if you ever want to build some sort of invisible, impenetrable barrier, now we know what you'd make it out of. When I saw that coincidence and I saw that article, I wrote an article for Wired.com about this, about graphene, using Iron Man as the example. And the comments section was just great. People commenting on this said, someone asked, what's protecting his hair then? And before I could say anything, someone provided the perfect answer. Brill cream, stopping bullets since 1928. Now, what is it that determines the strength of materials? Well, it's basically geometry and chemistry. So let me talk about each of those in turn. I will discuss the geometry and the strength of materials as it relates to an issue of the Fantastic Four that came out in the 1980s. This was a story that was like kind of a flashback story about an adventure the Fantastic Four had before they gained their powers when Earth was attacked by a giant monster, Gormu. And here, the creators of this Fantastic Four comic in the 1980s were doing a callback to the Marvel comics that Marvel put out before they published superhero comics. Before they published superhero comics, their comics were Tales to Astonish, Journey into Mystery, Tales of Suspense, that featured giant monsters attacking the Earth every month. Here we see Groot from Tales to Astonish 13 from 1961. And he says, behold, I am Groot, the invincible. Who dares to defy me? This was when he had more of a vocabulary and when he was trying to take over the Earth. And no matter whether it's Groot or anyone else, local law enforcement couldn't stop them, the military was helpless, and Earth would be doomed if not for the efforts of one lone scientist who inevitably figured out the one weakness that could defeat the giant invader. And here we see the very last panel from that story with Groot, and this man saying, well, I'll be, I never even thought of that. And a townsperson says, that's why Evans is a scientist, and you're only a sheriff. And Evans' wife hugs him saying, oh, darling, forgive me. I've been such a fool. I'll never complain about you again. Never. Personally, I can't tell you how often I hear that in my own household. Can't tell you because it involves imaginary numbers, but but it's a good thing that these scientists were on the case. Because if they didn't have to contend with Groot, they had to face Lokar, or Orgo, or Mumba, or Rambu, or Gruto, or Brutu, or Gugam, son of Goom, or Finfangfoom, all of which pale against the most terrifying monster of all, the tax collector from outer space. But back to Gormu, and what turns out to be an illustration of the square cube law. So Gormu comes to Earth and is trying to take over the planet. He's met initially by a scientist, Reed Richards, and Gormu declares his intentions. I'm Gormu, a warrior from Kralo. And his competitive advantage in the Earth-conquering business is that if you strike Gormu with any form of energy, a missile, a ray blast, anything, he gets bigger. So how do you stop someone where every time you hit them with anything, they get bigger? Well, everyone is flummoxed, military doesn't know what to do. Reed Richards, the scientist, has an idea. So he has a hypothesis, he goes back to where Gormu first landed, he takes out a small wooden ruler from his pocket and does an experiment and determines that the only way to stop Gormu is to continually bombard him with energy. So he keeps striking him again and again with an energy beam. Gormu initially thinks that it's a weapon, but then he says, no, not a weapon, a power beam. Yes, yes, give me more power, more. But wait, something is wrong. The power surges within me, but I do not grow stronger, I grow weaker. I'm almost as big as the planet, yet I do no damage. It is as if I'm no more than a phantom. What is happening to me? I am defeated. No. And Reed Richards, at the end of the story, explains that he had suspected that Gormu had been increasing at constant mass, not constant density. And he verified this by measuring the footprints and seeing that the footprints were getting bigger, but they were not getting deeper. And so he knew that he was not growing at constant density, but at constant mass. And I realized he was just gaining size. He was not gaining mass or weight. He was just inflating. Now Gormu, the infinite monster, has become truly infinite. And his fiancée, Sue Storm, says, oh, Reed, darling, I'll never doubt you again. But this is exactly right. Density is mass over volume. So another way to write it is that mass is density times volume. If you were to grow at constant density, then as the volume went up, the mass would go up. But if you grow at constant mass, then as the volume goes up, the density has to go down so that the product is the same. So and the strength of materials goes as the area, the square, not the cube. If you increase the mass of something, if you increase the size of something at constant density, then if you become 10 times bigger, then you're 10 times taller, but also 10 times wider, 10 times deeper. So it's 10 times 10 times 10, or 1,000. But the strength of your muscles, the strength of your bones, is not determined by their size, it's determined by their area. When you work out and your muscles get big, they don't get longer, they get fatter. And so if you want to hold up a 40-pound fish using a 20-pound line, you need another fishing line. You don't make it longer, you make it thicker. And this was explained in Squirrel Girl's physics class. where the professor is giving a lecture on the square cube law. Put it another way. Make yourself 10 times larger, your muscles get 100 times as big, but you have to carry 1,000 times more weight. That's why elephants look like elephants and not like giant mice. You can't just scale up animals and expect them to work. I drew them for you because I am a good professor. And so this also relates to the issue that I brought up with the filaments for the gecko lizard. The ratio of the surface area to the volume depends on whether we're looking at something small or something big. So for big objects, the surface area to volume ratio is small, whereas for small objects, the ratio of surface area to volume is big. We see this again in Squirrel Girl's class. Square cube law. As things get bigger, their surface area is the square of the growth factor, but their volume is cubed. Galileo discovered it. I drew him for you because I am a good professor. Now you know what you need to do to be a good professor. So that, by bringing up size, I want a brief interlude about nanotechnology, or does size matter? So a nanometer is 1/1,000,000,000 of a meter, and while that is kind of a meaningless number, I think of it as a nanometer is 3 atoms end to end. We can make nanoparticles that have a radius of only, say, 1 nanometer. And in that, since the size of an atom is finite, has a finite size, a 1 nanometer radius sphere has about 200 atoms in it. And we can build these things and we can study their properties. And they have very interesting properties, particularly about their surface area and the volume. A surface area to volume ratio is large for these small nanocrystals. In that 1 nanometer sphere that has 200 atoms, 140 atoms are on the surface, are on the outside, and only 60 of them are inside the sphere. A lot of chemistry takes place on surfaces. So nanocrystals are very good at catalyzing crystalline chemical reactions. And they can be used for drug delivery systems, attaching some molecule to the nanocrystal and getting it into the body to where it needs to go. The volume also is important because it's small. And when you make something in very, very small, the quantum mechanics dominates the properties of the material. So you can have a material, and now you can start to change their properties, tune them, just by changing the size of the particle. And that's exciting to us physicists because it frees us from the tyranny of chemistry. And by that, what I mean is, usually if you want to change the properties of a material, you have to change what the material is made of. So if I have a window and visible light passes through it, it absorbs ultraviolet light, it also absorbs some infrared light, but the visible light doesn't pass through, it has no color, because all the light, visible light passes through. If I want to change the color of the glass, I have to add other chemical elements to it, and thereby produce stained glass. So I add chromium or selenium or sulfur and vanadium, and I can change the color of the glass, but I'm changing the chemical composition of the glass. But there's another way to change an object's color, and that's by changing its size. So here is a series of suspensions of silicon nanoparticles from one of my colleagues at Minnesota. He shines ultraviolet light on it, and the silicon nanoparticles glow. And when he wants to change the color that they glow, he doesn't change that it's made of silicon. It's always silicon nanoparticles, but he just makes them smaller and smaller and smaller. So these are big silicon nanocrystals. They glow in the red. He makes them smaller. They grow orange, yellow, green, blue. So again, you can just tune the properties, not by changing the chemical composition, but changing the size. It gives us a new handle with which to control nature. And at this meeting, there are people talking about this, giving all sorts of talks about their research on nanotechnology. So this is part of this is why you hear about nanotechnology. People are interested in the surfaces, because whenever you need something to operate on a surface, it has a lot of surface area per volume. And by changing the volume, changing the size, you can change the properties of the material. But also, another way to change the properties of material is through chemistry. So, for example, looking at superhero costumes. Right? In order to avoid sanctions from the Comics Code Authority, superhero costumes have to adapt to when the superheroes use their powers. Right? When Kamala Khan, who has stretchy powers, stretches, we want her her costume to stretch along with her. Whether it's Elastic Girl of the Doom Patrol or Elastic Girl of the Incredibles, you need these costumes to adapt, and you need them to stretch and then come back to regular size when they've stopped stretching. Think about the Fantastic Four. Reed Richards gained the ability to stretch when he was bombarded with cosmic rays. I would not recommend it, but it worked for him. Sue Storm gained the ability to turn invisible, and she needs her costume to turn transparent when she turns invisible and then come back when she turns her power off. The Human Torch, when he bursts into flame, his costume, we like him when he turns his flame off for him to not be buck naked, so his costume has to be able to withstand those changes. All right, some people might think that that's okay, but... And the Thing has little blue shorts. Now, in the comic books, they actually explained how the costumes worked. They say here, special costume composed of unstable molecules, which can stretch and contract as his body does. Now, there are, in fact, unstable molecules. They're the ones that explode because they're unstable. But that's not what they're talking about. Here we see from the Human Torch's info page, my suit is made of unstable molecules. In their normal state, they look like this. But as my flame increases, they vary their structure depending on the degree of heat. Now, while there are not unstable molecules like that, there are materials that do basically the same thing, and they're called shape memory materials or thermal responsive materials. Materials that you can twist or distort, and then if you warm them up slightly, they snap back to their original configuration. If you've ever bought anything that was shrink-wrapped, you bought something that had a shape memory material, that it had a certain configuration, they wrapped the cellophane wrapping around it, sealed it up, and then they heated it up slightly, and it contracted and produced a tight seal around the object. So shrink wrapping is an example of shape memory materials. The metal frames and eyeglasses that can stretch and bend, and then you hold them under warm water and they snap back to the right shape. That's a shape memory material. And what this what these materials are doing is they're undergoing phase transitions. We're all familiar with phase transitions like ice melting to water or water boiling into steam. But there are other kinds of phase transitions, and people at this meeting study these, where you can go from one crystal structure to another, say by shearing the material, by squeezing it, or doing something else to deform it. And then it gets bent into another crystal structure, and then as you change the temperature, it can snap back to its original crystal structure and its original shape. There are fabrics that are called smart fabrics that can do this. They can expand, some of them can expand at lower temperatures, providing more insulation. Others can change their porosity when the weather is hot, when the temperature is high, so that it makes it easier for perspiration to cool you off. In the past few months, it was reported Stanford researchers have developed nanoporous materials that have holes small enough that both the perspiration and the infrared radiation that you emit when you're hot, well, you emit it all the time, but when you're hot, you emit more of it. It allows the infrared radiation to escape, but it blocks the visible light from coming in and warming you up again. So this is current research, 2017 stuff, that is relevant for the superhero costumes. If you talk about material science and superhero costumes, you got to talk about the accessories also. One example is Wonder Woman. She fights crime with her lasso of truth. I bring this up because it's an interesting historical fact that Wonder Woman was created in 1941 by a psychologist, Dr. William Moulton Marston, who is credited as one of the co-inventors of the lie detector machine. And so there we see where her lasso of truth came from. But she also has these bracelets with which she's able to deflect bullets thanks to her Amazonian reflexes and strength. But that, of course, assumes that the bullets are deflected from the bracelets in the first place. And so we can use, and in the comics, it's explained that the bracelets are made of Amazonian metal. But we can use physics to figure out what is Amazonian metal. If it can deflect, say, a 22 caliber bullet, we know the mass of that bullet. If we estimate how fast the bullet is going, then and we say that it collides with the bracelet and bounces off in about a millisecond, a thousandth of a second, then we use the physics equation that force times change in time, that's the impulse, is equal to times mv. Mv is the momentum. In physics, we usually represent that by the letter P because it stands for momentum. Rocket scientist. Well, we know all these numbers. We know the mass of the bullet. We know how fast it's going. We estimate it spends a thousandth of a second ricocheting. So we can figure out the force is nearly 3,000 pounds. It's over a very small area because we know the size of the bullet, which corresponds to a pressure of about 70,000 pounds per square inch. So what metal can withstand this pressure? It turns out pretty much all of them, right? Just regular high-strength steel alloys can easily withstand over 75,000 pounds per square inch. So apparently Amazonian metal is nothing more exotic than cold-rolled steel. But if we're talking about accessories, we've got to talk about one of the most famous costume accessories in superhero-dom, Captain America. Captain America has this shield, an indestructible shield, that has very unique properties. Captain America first appeared in March 1941. Here we see the very first issue of Captain America where he's slugging Hitler. This is March 1941. Pearl Harbor would not be until December 1941, but Captain America apparently has always been pro-punching Nazis. So he's always been on that side. If you ever wondered, is it okay to punch a Nazi? Captain America says yes. And when he first appeared, Captain America had a triangular shield, which turned out to be remarkably similar to the triangular shield by another superhero published by another company, The Shield. And The Shield's lawyers talked to Captain America's lawyers, and pretty soon Captain America had a circular shield. And as I say, it's got some very unique mechanical properties. The shield has tremendous strength and rigidity. Here we see Captain America throwing it and slicing a machine gun in half. He's throwing it and he's slicing an oak table. It's so rigid that it can bounce off of many surfaces, ricocheting, and he uses this to great effect. But the shield is also a great shock absorber. Here we see him deflecting a kick from Batroc Zilibert. Here he's deflecting a gun blast from a super scientist from Advanced Idea Mechanics. We know he's a super scientist because he's wearing a garbage can on his head. Here he's deflecting an explosion or a death beam. To be a good shock absorber, you don't want something stiff and rigid. You want something soft that gives, right? A good shock absorber for a shield would be a mattress. And you hold a mattress up in front of you and you say to someone who's trying to hit you, knock yourself out. And they punch the mattress and it doesn't really hurt you. But if you throw something that's soft and squishy like a mattress against the wall, it's not going to ricochet. It's going to just blop and stay there. Where does the energy go when it absorbs these shocks? Well, this was a great mystery that was finally resolved in the first Avengers film. that came out in 2012. Here we see Thor about to strike Captain America's shield. Now we know that energy is conserved. Energy can only be transformed from one form to another. When you strike the shield, there's all these vibrations in the shield that are the same way of basically incoherent sound waves. And apparently, those incoherent sound waves are transformed into light, which makes the shield an example of perfect sonoluminescence. So sono is sound, luminescence means it shines. And once again, they couldn't put it in a movie if it wasn't true. Now, what could his shield be made of that combines the strength and rigidity with the good shock-absorbing properties? Well, in the comic books, it was explained that the shield was created in a lab accident, and it is a unique alloy of steel and vibranium. Now, vibranium is an extraterrestrial mineral that is only found in the African nation of Wakanda, and it has the property that it absorbs all vibrations. Actually, now we know what it does. It absorbs the vibrations and turns them into light. Normally, normal vibrations like a gun blast or something don't give off enough light that we would notice it. When Thor's hammer struck, you couldn't miss it. But of course, the vibranium then makes it the perfect shock absorber. Now, I'm just not just making this up, okay? Here we see from the first time that the Black Panther appeared in Fantastic Four, our virtually inexhaustible supply of vibranium comes from the sacred mound, which has bordered the land of the Wakandans since the dawn of time. And eventually, the Black Panther actually made his costume out of vibranium, and we saw that in Captain America: Civil War, and someone in a helicopter is shooting machine gun, but his vibranium suit protects the Black Panther. It's just really getting him annoyed. But is this really true? As material scientists, we rely on experimental testing. And really, there's only one person who can verify the truthiness of the properties, the composition of Captain America's shield, and that is, of course, Stephen Colbert.
Meg, bring out that shield. Yes, that's the sound of indestructible Wakandan vibranium.
See? And if you ever wondered what it would sound like if you struck an object that absorbed all vibrations, now you know. So on that note of striking Cap Shield, I'd like to conclude. I want to thank you all for your attention and remind you that with physics comes great power and great responsibility. Thank you very much.
So I'm sure Jim would be happy to answer some questions. I think we have microphones here and over here if you'd be willing to come up to the microphone. Also, I would like to say we have a couple of books left that are up for sale. If you want to have his autograph, they're $15. If you want my autograph, $25. Think about it. My autograph in this book would be a lot more rare than his. So anyway, so questions for Jim?
I have one.
Hi.
Sir, my question is one that's been plagued us for a long time. Which is better, scientifically speaking, Marvel or DC Comics?
You know, I would say, so the question is, which is better, Marvel or DC Comics? I would say it depends when you're asking. In the 1960s, DC Comics, I would give the edge to. The writers and editors there were fans of the old science fiction pulp magazines, which tended to be what would now be called hard science. And they tried to put in, you know, make different aspects of the story scientifically accurate. A couple of examples from the, now in Marvel Comics, I think the Marvel Comics are better scientifically. And I say that just because a lot of the writers for Marvel send me emails with questions. And so, but say in DC Comics, here's two examples. One is something that was brought up on the very first episode of The Big Bang Theory. Someone wrote in and said, we saw Superman catch Lois Lane as she was falling from a building. But he's a man of steel, and she's going at high velocity, and he stops her. And wouldn't that kill Lois, the sudden stopping? And the editor of Superman wrote back, replied, and he said, obviously, Superman gave a little burst of super breath right before he catched Lois, decreasing her speed and thus being able to catch her safely. The other example was a few years later, and some physics majors at MIT wrote in, complaining that in a recent comic, Superman was shown traveling faster than the speed of light. And they objected, saying that Einstein's theory says that nothing can travel faster than the speed of light. To which the editor replied, Einstein is only a theory, Superman is fact. So I would say DC in the past, Marvel now.
Thank you.
Sure, thank you.
Yep. Hi, we had a random conversation in our department last week. and if we're using movies as evidence, the first X-Men movie, they use plastic against Magneto. So does that suggest that Magneto's powers come not from spin, but from current?
Well, let's see. Is plastic paramagnetic or diamagnetic? And so I think they're arguing that in the plastic they have all sorts of paired up electrons. All the electrons are tied up in chemical bonds, and so they're always spin paired. And so there's no net magnetic field for him to grab onto. I think that's the argument there. But no, but the Magneto has sometimes used his ability to control magnetism to control electronic currents. And in other comics, there are villains like Electro who have electric powers, and they've used that to create magnetic fields. So the basis of electromagnetism has definitely showed up in these comic books.
Thank you.
Questions?
Yes, there's someone over
question?
Here.
There we go. Oh, wait a minute. We got one here.
Yeah, okay. You're but next. You can come on in. Come on. You can get the next one.
Hi. I guess going off the movies, this is really sort of a reaching out imaginative kind of question. From the Iron Man suit to the Batman suit in the movie, you know, used for super soldiers, how far away do you think that sort of technology on a one-to-one human being, almost RoboCop-esque level, where we're encasing people in this technology, using that to port them around, using that.
Okay, so the question has to be, how far away is Iron Man from
if being real? Yes.
Yes. And, you know, it probably will not come as a tremendous surprise that the military is looking at this. I am aware. I mean, basically, the idea of building an exoskeleton that would enhance strength and some armor plating that would provide protection. They're looking at using nanoparticles in the plating so that it could spread the force of an impact around so that it doesn't penetrate through to the person underneath. Jet boots, those things exist. The problem is, as you see in the Iron Man movie, it's all powered by his arc reactor, which it puts out about the power of 3 nuclear power plants and is the size of a hockey puck. And if we knew how to do that, we wouldn't need superheroes. But one aspect of the Iron Man suit is a reality, and it's the one that they never really make a point of in the movies and barely in the comics. When Iron Man holds out his palm and shoots his repulsor ray, or he flies off with his boots, we never see him press a button or give a voice command. He just thinks it, and it happens. And in the comic books, this is explained by saying that he has a cybernetic helmet. That part is real. Scientists, engineers, one of my colleagues at Minnesota, Professor Bin He, in the Department of Biomedical Engineering, are developing cybernetic helmets that can detect the very weak electromagnetic waves that you create when you think and amplify them, send them via Bluetooth to some other device. If you go on YouTube, you can find, and you look for Bin He, B-I-N-H-E, and helicopter, you'll see a video where his graduate students are piloting a remote-controlled helicopter, but without holding any joystick, but simply thinking which way they want the helicopter to go, and it follows the trajectory. And Bin He and other scientists and engineers working on this technology are not trying to make Iron Man suits, they're trying to detect, to create better prosthetics, treatments for paralysis. But as a kid reading old Iron Man stories and Tales of Suspense, if you asked me in the 21st century which part of Iron Man would be a reality, I would not have predicted the cybernetic helmet. And so, but that is an example of the type of things that people are working on. It starts as basic research, or another way to think about it, essential research that gets at the fundamentals, and from there we can build up and we get the technology and the stuff that surrounds us that we have transformed our lives.
Thank you.
Sure.
Before you, there's
okay.
Somebody else.
Yeah, and then we'll get to you.
Okay, so when a member of the Lantern Corps flies close to the speed of light, are their powers affected by a Doppler shift? Or?
Okay, so the Green Lantern has a power ring, and that it enables him to create any, you know, three-dimensional structure, do anything, that it's basically fueled by his willpower. And so, let's see, if he's flying, first of all, when he's flying, his velocity is zero, right? It's everything else that's going past him. And so as long as nothing is going past him that gets shifted into the yellow, which is the one weakness the rings have, he should be fine. Okay, thanks. Speaking of accessories, yes.
Hi, just a little weird question about like your process. I find myself doing some calculations like your Wonder Woman bracelet kind of things a lot. And I wonder, like, how much leeway do you give yourself on things like the collision time with the bullet? Like, where'd you
get
that 1 millisecond?
So that's a great question. And part of that has to do with when I use this in the classroom, it's not the numbers themselves, it's the process. So if a character falls off a bridge and is caught in Spider-Man's webbing, and we want to know how fast she's going when the webbing reaches her, nowhere in the comic does it say, Gwen Stacy falls from the top of a bridge with an initial velocity of zero, and after falling 105 meters, that's not in the comic. So we have to make it a common sense estimate. We know the bridge tower is not 3 feet tall. We know it's not 3 miles tall. So we say, 300 feet. You know, let's say she's fallen 300 feet. Because what I'm trying to do is show the process. It's the same thing when we do a physics problem and we shoot a projectile at an angle of 37 degrees and we want to know the time it takes to reach a valley 200 meters below. You know, I've been doing this for many, many years. I've never needed to shoot a projectile at 37 degrees and know how long it takes to reach a valley 200 meters below. But it's the process that we're seeking to illustrate. And in some cases, maybe you fudge a little to get the numbers to kind of work out right. But then what that also enables you to do is to see, okay, how sensitive is it to the ricochet time, say the strength of Wonder Woman's bracelets? Does that matter much? And then you can vary that. And then you can say, does that rule out certain metals? And does that mean that it can't be regular steel, it has to be titanium steel or something like that? So you can do that.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there a concept or a technology that you haven't seen in comics that you would like to see?
More stunningly handsome physics professors. speaking of fantasy, that's a good question. Something I haven't seen in, you know, the thing is that they, one of the things would be that they tend to get quantum mechanics wrong, or, you know, they just use it as a hand-wavy magic act. And so it would be kind of interesting and nice if they got that more right. So I'm not quite sure, though. That's a good thing. I'll think about that. That's a good question.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think he was next.
Okay, and then we'll get to you.
I don't know if you've seen the new Logan movie.
Not yet.
Okay.
Do not spoil it, please. All right, I withdraw my question.
Okay. Well, Wolverine is technically unkillable. I mean, he heals. In the movie, he carries around a bullet made of animantium, which he is also animantium, suggesting that the bullet could pierce through him and kill him. I guess my question is a bullet made of the same material that he is strong enough to pierce himself?
Well, okay. Now I have to get my nerd on. Strictly speaking, his skeleton is laced with adamantium.
Okay.
He himself is not composed of adamantium. But I would say that the bullet wouldn't necessarily kill him if he was at the height of his powers, because Wolverine has a fast healing ability. So even if it went into his heart, say, it could pierce. It might be able to pierce or definitely ricochet off of any of his skeleton that is infused with adamantium. And it could, normally this would be a wound that would be fatal, but he has a fast healing ability. And in my class, a student made a presentation and asked the question, that's the nice thing about using the superheroes, is it gets you to focus on what is the break with reality. What's the minimum thing I have to change in order for this to work? So when you get a cut, it doesn't heal in 3 seconds, but it doesn't take 3 months. You know, it takes a certain length of time, and so that means that there's a time scale for the healing. And it will never happen faster than the slowest step in that healing chain. What is that step, and could you physically speed that up? You know, what would it take to do that? By looking at the superheroes, it gets you to focus on basic things, to not say, how would you get fast healing ability, but to say, how would I speed up this chemical reaction? And there, so that's the thing that I try to do in the classroom, at least, using the superheroes. And I happen to know, so you didn't spoil this for me, that he's starting to lose his fast healing abilities, and that's all they... Let me go see the movie, and then we'll talk.
Well, I guess the question, though, is, like, if a bullet was made out of the same material that you're shooting it into, would it stop it, or would it penetrate it?
I don't know. I think that, you know, his skeleton's made of adamantium. If someone shot me with a bullet made of bone, it would probably kill me, you know, if it went in the wrong place.
Okay.
So I would guess probably could be hurt.
Okay.
Taking out his fast healing ability.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Hey, Jim.
Hi.
Jim, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
My students call me Dr. K.
Hey.
The K stands for action.
Right on, Dr. K. In The Avengers, Age of Ultron.
Yes.
Tony Stark creates artificial intelligent robot on accident. My question is, which side of the debate of artificial intelligence do you lie on? You more Raymond Kurzweil, singularity, everything's all gravy, or are you Terminator 2, Independence, or no.
Yeah, no, Judgment Day.
Judgment Day, thank you.
it's so sad that I knew that instantly. I would say, I really would say, I think it's going to be more of a positive than a negative. I'm not fearful of our robot overlords, as long as we're the guys that keep our hand on the power cord. And so as long as we're able to unplug, I think we should be, But which raises an interesting question. If you had some sort of, you know, sentient, self-aware intelligence in a computer system, would turning the computer off or rebooting it, you know, be homicide or what have you? I don't know.
Right.
There are interesting questions, and interestingly enough, they are starting to move from the realm of just pure idle speculation into potential reality. I'm not as worried as other people are.
Right on. Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, Dr. Kakalios. Why is Galactus not spherical?
Because he's so big, you mean?
Yes.
Galactus is this enormous cosmic being who devours planets in order to have the energy to sustain himself. Just like we, and he doesn't care about the people that are destroyed, just like we're not really worried about the bacteria that are on the vegetables that we eat. We just wash them off and we cook them, those bacteria die, we cook them so the bacteria will die, and then we eat them. So Galactus is to us as we are to the amoeba. He's usually portrayed as this giant that's wearing the suit of armor that has these giant hockey sticks sticking out of his helmet. But that is the way that Earthmen perceive him. Other alien races, when they see Galactus as this cosmic power, view him in different ways. Okay. So he is just like a pure cosmic energy and doesn't have necessarily a shape. I had heard, one of my colleagues works on the LIGO experiment that detected the gravity waves, and they not only were able to confirm that this was a gravity wave, but recently they've been able to decode the message that was sent in the gravity wave, and it apparently was Galactus is coming. So I have a bad feeling about this.
So I had a question. You had said at the beginning that the students complain, oh, this is not relevant to my real life. It sounds to me like the thing that gets the students excited is that it's relevant to their imagination. And I was wondering two things. A couple years after the students take your class, is there one or two examples that just, they're like, hey, I remember that one time that really stuck with me? Or is it a different thing for a different person? And finally, for all of us physics teachers out here, what would be the lesson that you could teach us so that we can try to tap into that that relevance to imagination?
Right. The great questions. I've had students come back and remember different aspects. They will vary from student to student. The class that I teach is a freshman seminar that's open to anyone across the university. So I will have engineering majors and I will have art majors. And so I don't make exams because they would be simultaneously too easy and too hard for the range of students and their different backgrounds. What I do is I have the students make a presentation, and that way they can be as quantitative or qualitative as their background would enable them. I had one art major, not art history, an art major, and he wanted to analyze a panel from a Simpsons comic where Itchy and Scratchy, and the cat is in this plane flying, and he's flying to Brazil, and he's somewhere, and you see the curvature of the earth, and you see Brazil, and you know it's Brazil because it has Brazil written across it, like the country. And the question was, how high up is that plane for him to see this? And I said, well, okay, that if you want to make that your presentation, but I kind of think that there's, like, the geometry is going to be a little challenging to figure this out. And when he came in and he made his presentation, he said, I was kind of stuck on this, but then I saw in the library they had this large globe. So he took a sheet of transparency and he drew the plane, and then he stood back until the plane and the globe were lined up in the sheet the way they were in the panel, and then he could measure the distance to the globe and measure the size of the globe, And then if he looks up the size of the Earth, the radius of the Earth, he could figure out that the plane is like, you know, out in outer space or something. And it's an open air prop plane. So that was probably not right. But that process of problem solving, I do believe will stick with the students, particularly the students that are not science majors. If you screw up teaching basic physics in an intro class, the students are typically going to get it again and again in other sources. But when you have students that are liberal arts majors or humanities majors or anything, that this is their one physics class, getting them to memorize an equation is not going to stick with them. But if you can show them the process of reasoning or saying, how would we figure out how fast she's going? Let's make an estimate, you know, of the size. We know it's not a mile. We know it's not an inch. And that kind of process, I think that does stick with people. Basically, it's the scientific reasoning process. I think that these, and one size is not going to fit all. But for some people, and part of this is also the benefit. If I explain my research to Professor Dahlberg and I do a bad job, he will interrupt me. He'll ask questions because he has confidence that he should be able to understand what I'm saying. If I do the same bad job explaining my work to my next door neighbor, he will think he doesn't understand because he's not, quote unquote, smart enough when I just did a bad job explaining it. But if you tell the same story with Spider-Man or Superman, those shields don't go up right away. And if you could tie it to a storyline, there's a greater chance that people might actually remember it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. When you were talking about the Flash and that scene where he was getting heavier and couldn't travel to the speed of light, it made me think of how in the comics and in other mediums, it's like a plot point that the Flash can actually travel through time by going faster than the speed of light, and Superman does that in the first movie. So I was just wondering if you could comment on that trope in fiction.
Yeah. you know, like in the first Superman movie, when he flies around the Earth and he makes time go backwards, you can actually estimate how high up he is above the planet, and so you can figure out his the circumference of the orbit, and you count how long it takes for him to make those orbits, and you find that he's actually going faster than the speed of light. So that's why he's opening some rip in the space-time continuum. The writers tended to just take a very laissez-faire attitude about that. My own efforts to travel in time have not involved going faster than the speed of light, and that is all I'm willing to say about that at this point.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi. I guess kind of going off of that a little bit, but the other big thing in comics is the multiversity.
So, yes.
And it seems that pretty much people can travel between universes whenever they want. So can you give a brief comment on that?
Right. So there are clearly, yes. So one aspect from physics is one interpretation of quantum mechanics is the many worlds interpretation, which says that there's infinite number of parallel Earths. And this is a concept that was introduced in physics but was pretty much ignored by physicists until relatively recently, whereas it was taken very serious by the comic book writers when they started to bring in parallel Earths and use it to tell stories. Science fiction has been using these concepts for quite a while. Initially it was the Flash that could travel from these Earths because apparently all these Earths exist in the same point in space but are vibrating at different frequencies. So if you could vibrate super fast like the Flash, you'd be able to go from one to the other. In the absence of any hard evidence, I say that I just leave it open. But I wouldn't take, they're interesting ideas to explore, but I wouldn't go too far with that.
All right, thank you.
Sure.
Hi. Hi. Sorry, too many questions. But
no problem.
How exactly does Cyclops see?
How does Cyclops see? So Cyclops is a mutant member of the X-Men who shoots force beams from his eyes, and that are presumably controlled only by a visor he wears and his eyelids, presumably. And while he's shooting these force beams out, I guess, you know, while the light is coming out, other light is able to get in, so he's still able to see. I mean, one thing that they never show is if every action has a reaction, his head should be snapping backwards at several hundred miles per hour. So obviously, Cyclops has two superpowers, force beams from his eyes and an exceptionally strong neck muscles.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi.
Hi. Why do Kryptonians affect negatively by kryptonite when other species, such as humans or aliens, aren't affected?
Sure.
Even though they have already had contact with kryptonite.
That's a good question. So why is Superman weakened by kryptonite? Kryptonite are radioactive remnants of his home planet Krypton that have drifted to Earth. People have actually made estimates of the size of Krypton by figuring out how much kryptonite has actually diffused to Earth over the years. And so you can figure out the mass based upon how much was subtended by the solid angle of the Earth. Superman is weakened by it just the same way radioactive aspects of his home planet, the same way that we're weakened by radioactive elements here on Earth. Why it doesn't affect anyone else is because it's part of the story. Kryptonite has some amazing properties. In the first place, it is the only mineral that is immune to air drag, which explains why all the kryptonite didn't burn up in the atmosphere when it came to Earth. Because otherwise, you'd have like the atmosphere saturated with kryptonite dust, and Superman would be weakened whenever he flew. So it's immune to air drag, and kryptonite is the only mineral that exists because one man wanted to take a vacation. There was a Superman radio show that was on 5 days a week for 15 minutes, and the same actor played Clark Kent, played Superman, and he wanted to take a break. But how do you write 2 weeks of The Adventures of Superman without Superman or Clark Kent? So what the writers did is they invented kryptonite, and so these crooks had kidnapped Superman and weakened him with the kryptonite, and whenever they needed to go in the story and go back to Superman being held captive, they said, give him another dose of that kryptonite, and they'd bring it to him, and they'd have someone else moan in the microphone. Oh. So kryptonite was first introduced, and then it moved over into the comics. But it was first introduced in the Superman radio show, basically just so that one guy could get some time off.
Okay, thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
So, when opportunity arises, which superpower should I choose?
When you're struck by lightning by doing some other hazardous task, presumably also wallowing in radioactive waste, I personally, if it was me, this is actually kind of an interesting psychological thing to say what superpower you'd want. Personally, I would go with super speed. More than teleportation, you know, but super speed, every time I'm stuck in rush hour traffic or my flight's been delayed, right? I wish I had super speed. But also, with everything that you have to do in a day, it would be so great to be able to do it at super speed. As long as I could stop being at super speed. There's this one character who's always in super speed mode, and they say, why are you so cranky? It's like I'm living in the DMV. I'm working at this speed, and the rest of you are so slow. So you got to be able to turn it off.
So I think with that, the evening is over. We could have a round of applause for James. And I have one book left. So... Mm-hmm.
And if anyone else wants the book, it's available. And actually, for the physicists and also the non-physicists, I have a book, The Physics of Everyday Things, coming out this May. And it follows you throughout your day as you get up in the morning, make breakfast, you drive to a doctor's visit, you go to the airport through TSA, you give a business presentation, and throughout it, whenever you deal with some technology, it explains the basic physics, showing that this stuff actually is useful. So thank you all very much.